والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. المسلم والإنسان في هذه الدنيا مبتلى أي ممتحن، وهنا ليميز الخبيث من الطيب. فالمسلم وهو في هذه الحياة يعتصم بحبل الله بأمره ونهيه على ما كان عليه محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وأصحابه، والمسلم يقتدي ولا يبتدي في دين الله جل وعلا في العبادات والطاعات. ولذلك هو خاضع لأمر الله بما جاء عن الله جل وعلا.
So after praising Allah and sending salat wa salam upon his messenger, the Shaykh began by mentioning about how in this life Allah tests us, and that Allah tries us so that he may differentiate from us those who are good from those who are bad. And in order for us to succeed in this test, then upon us is to strive to follow what Allah had legislated. So we understand and we stick to and follow what is halal, what is haram. And we do things with the correct understanding of what the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with and what his noble companions radiallahu anhum understood. This is what is necessary upon the believer in order to be successful in these trials, in these tests, is that they seek to follow what has been legislated rather than trying to innovate something new that was not sent by Allah in the revelation.
فالإنسان قدر الله له الاختبار، ولذلك قال تعالى وإن كنا لمبتلين، فالله عز وجل يبتلينا بأوامره ونواهيه، أي أن العبد يختبر، وكذلك كان حال الأنبياء والرسل. ولذلك نرى مما بينه الله لنا في كتابه والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في سنته عن حال الأنبياء وكيف ابتلوا، كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم أشد الناس بلاء هم الأنبياء. ومن ذلك كمثال نوح عندما نادى وقال لابنه تعال معي للنجاة في السفينة، قال الابن سأأوي إلى جبل يعصمني يحميني يبعدني عن هذا الخطر. نوح جاء بالخبر والأمر، ابن نوح أخذ بدائرة العقل فقال الجبل عاصم، ولكن كانت النهاية بقول نوح لا عاصم اليوم من أمر الله، هذا أمر قضائي من الله جل وعلا. فحال بينهما الموج، أي فابتعدا، صار هناك إحالة مانع، فغرق ومات ابن نوح. نوح أخذ بالأوامر الإلهية، ابن نوح أخذ بالدائرة العقلية أن الجبل عاصم في مثل هذا الحال، ولكن كانت النتيجة على خلاف ذلك.
So indeed, in this life, we are tested and tried. And Allah described himself with this characteristic by saying, وَإِن كُنَّا لَمُبْتَلِينَ, that we are those who test. We are those who try. So the state or the situation of being tested, then this is from the qadr of Allah. This is from the qadr of Allah that each and every one of us faces. And Allah tests his slaves in different ways. And we know from the examples of the prophets, whom Allah sent and chose, that he tested them in different ways. And that the Prophet ﷺ said that indeed the most severely tested of the people are the prophets, then those who are most like them, then those who are most like them. So the state and situation of being tested by Allah, this is what Allah had decreed for us in this lifetime. And if we look from the examples of what has come in the Quran and the authentic Sunnah, then we have, for example, what happened with Prophet Nuh, alayhi salam, and the conversation that Allah informed us about in the Quran that Nuh had with his son. So Nuh's son, when the floods came, he said, which means, I will go to the mountain and that will protect me from the water. And Nuh tried to correct him by informing him that there is no protection today from the order of Allah, except whom Allah has mercy upon. So Nuh, alayhi salam, he stuck with following the revelation. He knew what was coming to his people based upon the revelation. As for his son, then he tried to follow his intellect. He used his intellect to convince himself that if he goes to the mountain, that this would protect him from the floodwaters. He tried to use his logic rather than following the revelation and following what Prophet Nuh had ordered him with. So then, as Allah informed, that the waves then came between them. So they became separated and distant from each other. They were no longer together because of the waves. So the son of Nuh, he did not follow what he was ordered with. Rather, he put his intellect and his own logic ahead, trying to seek refuge in the mountain, even though Nuh was mercifully trying to advise him that there is nothing that can save you from the order of Allah, except whom Allah has mercy upon.
وَإِنَّا كُنَّا لَمُبْتَلِينَ. Allah ابتلى نوح أن يرى ابنه أمام عينه لا يرتضي الحق ويهلك. إن أشد الناس بلاء هم الأنبياء. فيرى هذا الأمر بعينه. كيف أن الابن لم يأخذ بالأمر وأخذ بدائرته العقلية فكانت النتيجة الهلاك.
So if we look at this tremendous situation that Nuh عليه السلام was tested with, that he was trying to guide his son to the truth, and despite that, he witnessed his son's destruction with his own eyes. He saw that he was trying to guide his son, encourage his son to what was correct, but he was tested, as the most severely tested are the prophets. He saw his son reject the truth in front of him, and he saw him destroyed because he tried to put following his own intellect in front of following the revelation.
وانظر إلى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو ابن الستين يأتيه ابن ذكر اسمه إبراهيم أسماه بإبراهيم بعد سنة ونصف تقريبا يموت ويرى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ذلك وتدمع عين النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ويحزن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولكن لا يقول إلا حقا. فخسفت الشمس فقالوا هذا بسبب موت إبراهيم. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يقول إلا حقا في وقت الابتلاء. قال الشمس والقمر لا يكسفان لموت أحد أو لحياة أحد، إنما هذه مسألة خاضعة لله جل وعلا، قوموا للصلاة. لم يسخر هذا الأمر الحزن لأن يتنازل عن النطق بالحق، بل هو عليه وهكذا هدي الأنبياء والرسل.
So we also have the example of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that when he was in his 60s, that he was provided with and blessed with a son that he named Ibrahim. And the boy, he lived for a year or a year and a half approximately, and then he died in front of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he was, of course, affected with sadness due to this event, and he cried. But even though he was not, in that situation and tested with that trial, he did not speak except the truth. So on that very same day, there was an eclipse. There was an eclipse, and the people started to say that the eclipse is because the son of the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ibrahim, had died. So the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not let his sadness emotionally affect what he would say about this eclipse, but rather he said clearly in front of the people that indeed the sun or the moon, they do not eclipse due to the death of anyone or the life of anyone. Rather, and then he ordered them to establish the prayer, to establish the eclipse prayer. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not let his sadness take advantage of that situation, but rather he stuck with the truth and only spoke with the truth.
وانظر إلى إبراهيم عندما أخذ زوجه مع ابن الرضيع إسماعيل ووضعهم في واد غير ذي زرع وتركهم، وكان زوج إبراهيم تقول إلى من تتركنا؟ إلى من؟ وإبراهيم لا يلتفت، إلى أن قالت الله، انظر ماذا تقول هاجر زوج إبراهيم، الله أمرك بهذا؟ قال إبراهيم نعم، قالت لن يضيعنا الله. انظر إلى امتحان الأنبياء والرسل، انظر كيف يختبر الإنسان، وأشد الناس ابتلاء وبلاء هم الأنبياء ثم الأدنى فالأدنى. فانظر إلى موقف إبراهيم، وانظر إلى موقف زوج إبراهيم، التسليم لأمر الله والرضا وعدم النطق إلا بالحق المبين، ما يرضي الله، لا نقول إلا ما يرضي الله. هذه منهجية من يبتلى في هذه الحياة، عليه بالصبر. نعم قد يبكي قد يحزن، ولكن لا يقول لا يتلفظ إلا حقا ما يرضي الله جل وعلا. وأقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم.
So we also have the example of Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was ordered by Allah to leave his wife Hajar and his breastfeeding son Ismail in the desert, that desert which later became Mecca. So he left them by the order of Allah in this valley that, as Allah described it, that there was no crops there of any kind, left them alone there in the sand and turned and walked away from them. And his wife was asking, who are you leaving us for? who are you leaving us for? Who is going to take care of us while we're here? And Ibrahim, he just kept going. He didn't respond. So then she asked, is it Allah that ordered you with this? Is it Allah that ordered you with this? And
call Ibrahim Shay.
لا لم يقل إبراهيم إلا عندما سئل قالت الله أمرك بها قال نعم فقط.
So then Ibrahim responded yes after she asked that. So then she said, then indeed Allah will not waste us away. So Ibrahim continued and left, and she remained patient and steadfast, relying upon Allah. And so we see from this example the severity of trials that the prophets had faced. And we see that they did not speak except with the truth. So it is upon every believer that when we are tested, when we are tried, that we only say what is pleasing to Allah. We might be affected by sadness. We might feel sadness. We might cry. But we don't let that emotion carry us to do or say anything that is in displeasure to Allah. Rather, we only say what is pleasing to Allah, and we stick and remain upon the truth. Just like we have the examples of the prophets and messengers, and we know that they were the most severely tested, and then those who are most like them, and then those who are most like them. Now. If there's any question specifically related to the topic, please, then you could click the raise hand button. Okay, Jazakumullah khairan. Oh, just one person is just now. Okay, Muhammad.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Yes, my question is regarding the story of Nuh alayhi salam, that he took care of his son, like he even gave da'wah till the end. So I just want to know if, let's say, a parent and the son is not following the right way, like not as in he has bad habits. So is it an obligation for the parent to guide, to advise him and stay with him till the end? Or if the parent wishes to ask him to maybe find a separate way, how much can the parent go for the child?
المسلم مبتلى كما هو عنوان هذا الدرس من الآية الكريمة فيجب على المسلم أن يبذل الوسع والطاقة أن يبذل كل ما في وسعه وكل ما في طاقته وأن يكون حكيما في فعله وقوله وهديه فهذه الأشياء مؤثرة فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في دعوته للناس تجد أن هنا صنع معهم شيء يختلف عن الآخر يختلف عن الثالث والرابع والخامس فلا بد من الاختيار المناسب في البيان وفي الفعل مع الشخص المدعو لأن الناس تختلف متباينة فالابن لا نكرر عليه ما لم يكن مؤثر عليه بل نحاول بشتى الطرق دعوت قومي ليلا ونهارا إذن يصنع ما بوسعه للوصول إلى هداية الابن
نعم So the Shaykh began by reminding that everyone is tested and trialed, as was the topic of this lesson. So this is something that we will face. And it is important that when you're striving to give dawah and to help bring about guidance to anyone, that we have hikmah, right? That we use wisdom in those situations. And from the wisdom that we see from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that when he would give his dawah and he would try to bring about guidance for people by Allah's permission, that he did not deal with each individual in the exact same way, but rather he spoke with certain individuals in one way. He tried to give dawah to other people another way. And a third type of person, he used another method or another type of mannerisms and so forth. So it's very important that you focus on trying to use those methods and those means and those ways of convincing that are appropriate for each and every individual. So when you're trying to advise a son, for example, then you want to not continually repeat something that you don't see is being beneficial. You don't want to repeat the same thing in the same way that you're not seeing the effect, but rather we try different angles, different ways to try and bring about that guidance by Allah's permission. And Allah described, or he told us and informed us about Nuh alayhi salam, that he said, indeed, I called my people, I gave dawah to my people in the day and the night, right? And that was over a period of many years. So this is from what is upon anybody that is seeking to bring about the guidance for people is that they strive to the best of their abilities, put forth the best and most effort that they are able to, following the correct means, and being sincere in that.
ويتوج هذا الكلام الذي ذكرناه بالدعاء له. يجب عليك أن تلح بالدعاء له بالهداية وب يعني العبودية لله جل وعلا وهذا الأمر من القربة إلى الله فالقلوب بين إصبعي الرحمن يقلبهما كما شاء جل وعلا فما يجب على الإنسان أن يسلك الطرق التي تكون محببة للذي أمامه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يأتي اليهودي فيسأله عن أشياء فيجيب يأتي الفارسي فينظر إلى ظهره فيهتدي يأتي المسلم ويأتي العربي فيسمع القرآن فيهتدي يأتي الإنسان البسيط فيعطيه من المال حتى يرى من خلاله أنه لا يخاف الفقر متكل على الله جل وعلا إذن الناس متباينة الناس متباينة والابن كذلك فيجب على الإنسان أن يرى ما الشيء المناسب لابني في البيان والدعوة من حيث الفعل والعمل هي ليست قضية قلت له وكفى بل نحاول هنا وهناك بطرق مختلفة نعم.
So accompanying what we said previously about this issue is also you should be making dua, you should be supplicating to Allah for the guidance of this person, that you should submit to the fact of you being a slave to Allah and that you turn to Allah and supplicate to Allah for their guidance. And likewise, that we try the different ways that we find how the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would seek to bring about guidance for different individuals. And we look to see what is appropriate and suitable for the people that we are trying to bring about guidance for. So from the examples, we find that different Jews would come to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asking questions. And the Prophet would answer their questions. So that was from his trying to bring about guidance for them. Likewise, we have the example of Salman al-Farsi, radiallahu anhu, that he wanted to see the birthmark on the back of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's what helped bring about guidance for him. And likewise, some of the Bedouins, when they would come and visit the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they would hear the Quran. And that would be a means that would help bring about guidance for them. And there might be some, there was other people that once they saw that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, gave them from wealth, and that the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not fear falling into poverty because of his trust in Allah, that was a means of bringing about guidance for them. So many different kinds of people need different types or ways to try and guide them to the truth. So it's upon you to continually strive and see what works and what has the best effect for who you are trying to bring about guidance for. And
it's not... Right.
So don't allow yourself to be bored from that, and don't become tired of it. And it's not enough for you to simply say, either out loud or to yourself, oh, I already told him, or I already said that. No, keep trying, keep patiently trying different ways to see how you can try to bring about positive results.
With happy face and a smiley face, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أشد الناس أكثر الناس ابتساما كما يقول أنس فالابتسامة هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم هذا ينعكس على الابن على الأسرة.
So the Messenger of Allah, so the Anas radiallahu anhu, he described the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as being the people that that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the person who used to smile the most. So this is from the characteristics and guidance of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that people would see him smiling, they would see him happy. So when you act like that, when you're smiling and happy within your home, then it brings about a positive reflection upon your household, upon your family, that they see you like that. So this is how you should strive to be while you're giving your dawah and trying to bring about guidance of someone. Yeah, and you be the best example. You yourself be the best example.
JazakAllah khair.
JazakAllah khair for the answer.
Okay, Yawar?
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum assalam.
Okay, Sheikh, I have a question. There's a hadith which says that the reward of the Sahabi of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is like if they even give a date or half a date is better than what we give even a mountain of wood of gold. And there's also one hadith which I have heard that in the times ahead, days of patience, when if a person holds on to the sunnah, then he'll be rewarded like 50 of companions. So how do we reconcile between these two? How do we understand these two?
We understand that the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم وأرضاهم لهم مكانة ليست لنا ولا لغيرنا ممن أتى بعدهم فالصحابة ما كانتهم عظيمة ولكن قد يمنح الله عز وجل الأجر للعبد فيما شاء فالله كريم ذو الجلال والإكرام فننظر إلى هذا الأثر من خلال كرم الله وفضل الله لا من حيث المقارنة بين الفاعل لهذا الفعل وبين أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى لا يقع الإنسان في موقع لا يرتضى فالصحابة بإجماع الأمة أن أي من الصحابة هو أعظم من سائر من يأتي بعدهم. هذه عقيدة. أما الأحاديث التي تقول أن يكون للأجر الواحد كخمسين ممن كذا، فهذه من باب كرم الله وفضل الله علينا، هكذا نفهم. كما لما يسمع الإنسان ولو كان خطأه كزبد البحر، على ظاهره نأخذ الحديث في الأول والآخر، ولكن نفهم من ذلك فضل الله العظيم أنه الكريم لا إله إلا هو.
So the first thing to remember and to recognize is that the status of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and their virtue cannot be compared with anyone that comes after them. Any single individual from the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam are better in status and virtue than any individual that comes after them. As for the hadith that you mentioned about the one that clings to his religion in the times of difficulty, that their reward is like 50 of the companions, then we understand and reflect upon these types of narrations or these types of hadith, emphasizing the generosity and the virtue of Allah. The generosity and virtue of Allah, and that Allah multiplies rewards for whomever he wills. And from the examples of this hadith, or that have this similar angle of emphasizing Allah's generosity, is the ahadith that say, for example, that if you say such and such adhkar, that your sins will be forgiven, even if they are the amount of the foam of the sea, the white foam that forms in the water of the ocean. Even if your sins are as much as that foam in the sea, that Allah will forgive your sins. So we accept these ahadith as they have come. We don't try and change the interpretation, rather we understand them with their apparent meaning in how they emphasize and show how glorious and tremendous Allah's generosity and kindness is. And we do not mix that or use that to distort our understanding of the companions, radiallahu anhum, being better in status and virtue than anyone who comes after them.
القاعدة عندنا أن صحبة النبي ومن لقي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يعدلها عمل لمن يأتي بعدهم إلى يوم القيامة.
Okay, so there's a principle that we understand and that we believe in, is that whoever had met the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, believing him in him, and he died upon that, then that virtue is better than any deed of anyone else that could come after them. That in itself is better than any other deed, that virtue that Allah has blessed those individuals with.
Amma alladhi yasbur fi آخر الزمان وله الأجر فهذا فضل الله عليه، ولكن لا ينفي المعنى الأول الذي عليه إجماع الأمة.
So the one who is patient in the later times, then that multiplying of his reward is from the favor of Allah upon him, and that doesn't negate what we mentioned about the virtue and status of the companions.
جزاك الله خير.
Well, we'll continue. We'll see you next time. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum.